ओके सॉरी गाइस, यू विल टू व्यू माय स्क्रीन। ओके तो वेलकम टू दिस व्हीकल डायनेमिक्स वर्कशॉप। सो बिफोर स्टार्टिंग लेट्स अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट विल बी द कोर्स मॉड्यूल फॉर दिस वर्कशॉप एंड व्हाट विल बी द डिफरेंट टॉपिक्स दैट आर गोइंग टू बी डिस्कस्ड। नाउ दीज आर नॉट all the topics, there will be of course more topics as I've said that after hearing your chat box suggestions we'll be of course adding your suggestions to it too. So the basic topics that are going to be covered will be day one, that is today, we'll be understanding what exactly is vehicle dynamics, what are the different applications of vehicle dynamics and vehicle dynamics in electric vehicles, and what are the job opportunities and job roles that you will be having if you join any company as a vehicle dynamics engineer. Next day, that is tomorrow, we'll be understanding what is tire mechanics, how a tire is constructed, what is tire nomenclature, and we'll come to know in detail what is grip. On the third day, the third day will consist of studying different concepts of vehicle dynamics and different parameters such as camber, what is camber, caster, kingpin, dive, squat, roll centers, and many other parameters, and how these parameters each affect the motion of the vehicle. And on the last day, we'll be understanding your steering principles, like what is Ackermann, what are slip angles, how do they affect the vehicle, and then we'll be familiarizing ourselves with some calculations and formulas which are basically used in vehicle dynamic calculations. And at the end, we'll be trying to model based upon our learning of the entire vehicle dynamic setup process. We'll be modeling a suspension and steering setup from scratch, using a suspensions and steering analysis and modeling software, which will be Lotus V4. So that will be on the last day. And then of course, at the end of each day, we'll be having a Q&A session. That is a question and answer session where you'll be asking your questions and we'll be clearing the doubts. Okay. So what is the agenda for today? So our agenda for today will be as follows. So first we'll be understanding the field of vehicle dynamics, what exactly is vehicle dynamics and why we need to be aware about it. Next will come understanding how vehicle dynamics improves vehicle performance. Third topic will be vehicle dynamics in electric vehicles, and last will be your job opportunities in the field of vehicle dynamics. So today we'll be taking it a bit slow because the first day bombarding you with the technical details and technical stuff will seem a bit tiring and exhausting. So let's start slow. First, let's get to know what is vehicle dynamics, because as I read in the chat box, many of you guys are freshers. So being freshers, many of you might not be aware of what vehicle dynamics exactly is and why is it important. So we'll be starting off with that. Okay. So let's begin. So vehicle dynamics is a study of vehicle behavior when subjected to different inputs with respect to a solid surface. It consists of studying how the vehicle responds to cornering, roll, pitch, bumps, acceleration, braking, and various other motions. So basically, vehicle dynamics is nothing but like when you drive your car on the road, your car will be subjected to various motions, correct? So these motions will be like when you're accelerating the car, it is a motion. When you're braking the car, it's a motion. When you're cornering, when you're taking a left-hand turn or a right-hand turn, it's a motion. So we need to understand how the vehicle is going to respond to these motions, at what speed the vehicle behavior will change, because when we are able to understand, only then we'll be able to provide a car which is number one drivable, number two safe. Safety is the primary importance for any design engineer or vehicle dynamics engineer when they are designing or developing a car. We'll also need to understand how the vehicle will behave when it goes over a bump, and especially for Indian road conditions, it is very important because the road conditions in India are not as good as compared to various other countries. So if you are a vehicle dynamics engineer developing a vehicle for India, it is very important to understand what is bump steer, how the toe angle changes. We'll get to know what is toe angle, what is bump steer, etc. later on in the workshop. Don't worry about it. So that is that. And then we'll start with the basics now. So any vehicle, be it four-wheeler, SUV, hatchback, sedan, any vehicle will have three basic sets of motion. First will be your yaw motion, then your roll motion, and your pitch motion. Now, these three motions occur in three different axes. So first will be your x axis, your y axis, and your z axis. So what are these three axes? So x axis is basically the axis running along the length of the car, which you can see is colored in black here. So this is your x axis, which is runs from the front of the vehicle to the rear of the vehicle. Then comes your y axis. Now y axis is a line running across the vehicle, that is your width of the vehicle. So it will run from your left tire to your right tire. So in that axis, your pitching motion occurs. And then third, we have the z axis, which is the height of the vehicle, which is runs from the bottom of the vehicle, which is your base plate, to the top of the vehicle, that is your roof. Now in these three axes, each have their own different sets of motion. For example, if your car is revolving around the x axis, then it is called as rolling motion. If your car is rolling, if your car is revolving around the y axis, we call it the pitching motion. And if your car is revolving around the z axis, we call this as the yaw motion. So we'll be seeing how these motions work later on when we start modeling our suspension system. Then you'll be easily be able to visualize it. For now, just imagine your car revolving, like taking a 360 degree revolution along these three axes. So this x axis is roll, y axis is pitch, and z axis is your motion. Now, what are the applications of vehicle dynamics? Like, where do we apply these vehicle dynamic principles, and how is it useful? So having the correct vehicle dynamic setup for a vehicle helps the driver in many ways, such as, number one, for day-to-day driving, it provides better ride comfort, especially on bumpy roads. So if you're having a vehicle which has excellent vehicle dynamics, what will happen is, even if you're going through a bumpy road, let's say your village roads or your city roads when it during the monsoon season, so you won't feel the jerk of the bumps when the car drives over it. As a result, you'll have a very safe and smooth ride. So the driver will also be at comfort. He won't tire out while driving, because we've seen many drivers completely getting tired out after driving throughout the city, especially your cab drivers, your Ola and Uber drivers. They are driving throughout the city, throughout the day. So if the cars that is that the cars that Ola and Uber and these companies use are basically a domestic cars, hatchbacks and sedans. So when they don't have good vehicle dynamics, what will happen is the driver will start tiring out. And if he starts tiring out, he won't be able to drive throughout the day and throughout bad road conditions. So it's very important that your vehicle has excellent vehicle dynamic setup in order to survive these bumps and potholes. Next, it provides better handling performance at both high speeds and low speeds. Now, handling performance is something we do associate with urban cities, like where you have to navigate through various streets, roads, and what we call as gullies in India. So that is one aspect. But when it comes to handling performance, we generally consider it from a motorsport point of view, wherein you need to take sharp turns at very high speeds. And some of those sharp turns will also come at very low speeds. Like you'll have your high speed corners and your low speed corners. So any vehicle with a correct vehicle dynamic setup will of course perform better and will take these corners at a much greater speed compared to a vehicle with a let's say not so good vehicle dynamic setup. So it does help you in providing better handling performance at both high and low speeds. Next, provides better vehicle stability for more confident driving. Now there's one thing about when we say let's say motorsports or normal driving conditions, is that until unless the driver has complete confidence on the machine, he won't be able to extract the maximum performance out of it. And that confidence comes with stability. So if your car is not if your car doesn't have a good let's say drivability or doesn't handle pretty well, the driver of course will not be confident going into a turn, going into a corner, or let's say even overtaking during traffic. He won't be very confident, because if let's say you have too much of oversteer or understeer, which are concepts we'll be discussing later on, so he won't be confident with it. So there is a very high chance that he can slip and slide, and he, because of that risk, that fear in his mind that his car may swirl out of control, he won't be able to extract the maximum performance out of it. Just give me 1 minute. Fourth point, car with the wrong vehicle dynamic setup has a greater chance of getting involved in accidents. So there are various cases of road accidents which we encounter day to day, where in most cases we see that either the car has toppled over because of taking a very sharp turn, which is especially in the case of SUVs and compact SUVs and the bigger vehicles. Because these vehicles, since they are big, they have a high center of gravity. Again, center of gravity is a topic which we will be discussing later on, so don't worry about it. We'll be explaining each and every topic we are discussing right now in detail. So yeah, as I was discussing, so SUVs, which are the most selling vehicles right now, like the entire SUV, like SUV crossover, the entire segment, there are various sub segments you can call, like crossovers are there, compact SUVs are there, the whole segment. These bigger cars have a very high tendency to roll over and topple over. So it's very, very essential that the vehicle dynamics of these cars are specially looked at in detail and they are configured with absolute precision. Because even if, let's say, your center of gravity is off by a small amount, there's a very high chance that the car may topple over when, let's say, you're taking a sharp turn. For example, when you're driving your car on the road and suddenly, let's say, animal or cow or another vehicle comes in front of you and swivel to another side. So when you swivel to the other side, what happens? The center of gravity throws the car away in a rolling motion and the car completely topples over. So it's very important that to avoid such a situation, and that when a driver takes a sudden turn or a sharp turn, when he's panicking on the road, the car shouldn't go out of control and should remain in control. So it's very important for that aspect also. Now, I guess so many of you being Baja and Formula student enthusiasts, so if you are into motorsports, that is also a very good field. So in motorsports like Formula One, IndyCar, World Rally Championship, the vehicle dynamic setup plays one of the most major roles in motor racing. Why? Because I've explained it with an example here. In the 2018 Formula One season, so Ferrari had a much, much better engine compared to the other cars on the grid. But still, it wasn't able to take the podium, and nor was it able to dominate the competition like Mercedes did. This is primarily because, number one, Mercedes had a very good vehicle dynamic setup in their cars. That the drivers, especially, yes, the driver skill also plays a part. Lewis Hamilton and Valtteri Bottas were excellent drivers, but also they also had a very good car in terms of driving stability and cornering performance. Along with the aerodynamic downforce was there too. So this was the reason that Ferrari, even though it was faster on the straights, as reported by the Mercedes drivers themselves, they weren't able to defeat or they weren't able to win the podium races. This is simply because the Mercedes cars were better at handling. They had better cornering performance. The drivers were more confident going into corners, which enabled them to take more risks as compared to the drivers from Ferrari, that is Sebastian Vettel. So that is another aspect of vehicle dynamics, that as I was saying previously, that if your car has a good vehicle dynamic setup, you'll be more confident on the turns. You'll be more confident on the turns and you'll be able to extract much greater performance out of them. So next, coming towards the modern era, that is vehicle dynamics and electric vehicles. Now, since the beginning, let's say from the 1950s to 60s, yes, vehicle dynamics has evolved a lot. Previously, we used to have just double wishbone suspensions, then leaf spring suspensions were there, which are still there in commercial trucks and commercial vehicles. But our complete leaf springs and the entire leaf spring setup is completely obsolete from domestic cars. So most domestic cars used to use a double wishbone setup, but now with the advancement of simulation techniques, etc., we have various different types of suspension setups coming in. As you'll see with the case of especially sports cars and hypercars, like for example, Koenigsegg introduced a very good suspension system recently called the Triplex suspension, You can read about it, or we can discuss it later on. What is a triplex suspension and how it is innovative? And then we had the Mercedes Project One. It also introduced a very new sort of suspension setup using electronic dampers, etc. Then Formula One always has, let's say, innovations done in the suspension and steering geometry part. However, most of this entire vehicle dynamic concept, the designing of the suspension and steering geometry, has always been a very complex and risky procedure, because either you'll get it completely right or your car will be completely undrivable. So what used to happen, the primary reason for this was most of these vehicles that we used to use previously were based on IC engines, correct? So now IC engines are very bulky vehicles, number one. Number two, most of the components in an IC engine, which I'll be showing later on in the next slide, that is, most of the components in the IC engines are in IC engine based vehicles are placed comparatively higher. Like you have your engine right up till the engine bonnet. So what this does is, because the components are so many, there are so many components in an IC engine vehicle, and the components are placed very high in the vehicle. So this increases your center of gravity of the vehicle. Now, when your center of gravity increases, again, the car's tendency to roll increases. So as a result, what happens? Your car needs a very complex set of vehicle dynamic control parameters, like your anti-roll bars, and there are various other components also in order to restrict those rolling motions and make the vehicle drivable and more safer. So introducing so many new components used to make the car more complex. However, with electric vehicles, what has happened is the entire power unit, train unit, has been completely changed. The number of components has lessened, the complexity of the powertrain components has lessened, and the components are placed very low in the car. So what happens? This naturally solves many problems of vehicle dynamics automatically. So we'll be seeing in the next images. So as I was discussing, yeah, we can see the points here. So the first point being, it lowers the center of gravity, that is your COG. It reduces the tendency, the tendency of the vehicle to roll during sharp turns. It reduces the risk of vehicles toppling over in an accident, and simplifying the suspension geometry setup, thereby reducing manufacturing cost and time. So let's see the vehicles here. So on the left, you have a normal IC engine vehicle. So as you can see, the engine is completely placed high up. So this increases the center of gravity of the vehicle. As a result, what happens when your car is taking, suppose, a left turn or a right turn, because of the center of gravity, the car will try to roll over or topple over to one side. And in order to restrict this motion, you'll have a various complex set of suspension geometries placed here and towards the wheels. This will include rocker arms, your double wishbone suspension setup, your anti-roll bars, clamps for your anti-roll bars. It becomes very complex, and even after such complexity, your car isn't completely safe, because these are just meant to reduce the effect of roll. However, you still be having a lot of roll in your car. Now, on the right, when we look at this electric vehicle, so what happens is, as you can see, the biggest and most heaviest component in the IC engine here is the entire engine and transmission unit itself, which is placed comparatively higher. But in the electric vehicle, what happens? Your biggest and the most bulkiest portion of the powertrain unit, which is your battery pack, is placed at the absolute base of the vehicle. So below this, you only have your base plate, which protects the battery pack, of course, from your like obstructions in the road, like bumps, pebbles, rocks, stones, etc. So majority of the weight of the powertrain unit is focused at the absolute bottommost portion of the vehicle. And then, even if your motors and inverters are there, and other powertrain components, they are not as bulky as an IC engine, and they are also placed very, very low. They are placed just above the battery pack. So this reduces your center of gravity by a lot. So even if your car, let's say in an accidental situation, even if your car is toppling over, what will happen? Like, the car is on two wheels, you've taken a very sharp turn, and these two wheels are in the air, and your car is on these two wheels alone. Even then, what happens? Since the weight of the majority weight of the vehicle is at the bottommost portion, it will try to pull the car down. So when it pulls the car down, your car won't topple over. As you'll see very various videos of Tesla doing their rollover testing. So Tesla cars cannot be toppled. So that this is what they were trying to show. So what happened was they brought in a probe which did try to flip the car to the other side, but the car just wouldn't flip. Every time it went on two wheels in the air, it used to just come back up and sit straight. And it refused to topple over even without an anti-roll bar. So that is a very big achievement that is simply not possible in a IC engine vehicle. So this is let's say a major area where electric vehicles have solved the complexity of vehicle dynamics in vehicles. So till now we have discussed what is vehicle dynamics, what are the different applications, and how electric vehicles have changed the vehicle dynamics field in the automotive industry. Next, we'll be talking about what are the different job opportunities and responsibilities of vehicle dynamics. Now, most of the freshers in engineering, like I'm talking about my days, I don't know what the curriculum is right now and how what students are being taught in their engineering schools right now. But when we were graduating from engineering, we were absolutely unaware of this entire topic called vehicle dynamics because it wasn't there in our curriculum. And even I had some friends in automotive engineering. I took up mechanical engineering. I had some friends in automotive engineering. Even they used to say they had vehicle dynamic topics, but it wasn't covered in detail to a point where they could set up their own car. Now, as a result, what happened? There was a very huge deficiency of engineers understanding the vehicle dynamics concept. As a result, what used to happen is you had companies like Tata Motors, Mahindra, which have their development centers and our research and development centers in India itself. They used to always lack proper vehicle dynamic engineers. So mostly either they used to outsource those engineers from foreign countries, or they used to just take like students from the premier institutions. Now what has happened is as more and more you have these online platforms like Shiksha is there, and various other organizations are there which do provide students with this. So you'll be better accustomed to knowing these topics, and you can easily get employed in these topics because these are job positions of a vehicle dynamics engineer. So if you are studying vehicle dynamics, you'll be recruited as a vehicle dynamics engineer. It's not that the opportunities in vehicle dynamics are scarce, but it is the question that students do not have the right amount of quality. So be thorough with your concepts, get it cleared with us, and we'll help you to get recruited in a vehicle dynamics company. As a vehicle dynamics engineer, we'll try our best. Next thing is, what are the different roles and responsibilities? What are the, let's say, compensations offered? Now, vehicle dynamics positions are open since, like, even if you go to LinkedIn right now, you'll find various positions for vehicle dynamics engineers open, which have been lying vacant for months on end. So there are very, very less engineers in India who are into this field. So it is a completely open window for you guys to get into it and find yourself a job in a top automotive OEM. So these are the some of the roles and responsibilities which you'll be having when you join any OEM as a vehicle dynamics engineer. Number first, you'll be required to understand the overall build of the vehicle. Any vehicle dynamics engineer, apart from knowing your vehicle dynamics, your suspension system, steering systems, needs also to know the entire architecture of the vehicle. Why? Because now, yeah, one question I'd like to ask you guys, I want you to post your answers in the chat box, is how do you think the vehicle development process goes on? Like when you're, let's say, developing a four-wheeler, what do you think is the first component that gets designed or gets conceptualized? I want you guys to write your answers in the chat box. So basically, I'm asking, like, what is the first step in the vehicle development process? Anyone?
Sir, we have posted on the chat, sir.
Okay, so I've seen some answers. So most of you guys, some of you guys are seeing chassis, some of you guys are seeing tires, some of you guys are seeing chassis and BMW, BIW, sorry, that is body in white. Designing. What segment of car they are dealing with? Well, this question is segment irrespective of the segment. Let's say any car. Let's okay, but for your consideration, let's say if you're designing a hatchback. So what do you think should be the first consideration any automotive engineer should take before developing a hatchback? Like, what should be the starting point? Okay, so any more answers? Okay. So I see Krishna Teja and Akash Yadav, they have commented suspension hard points and proportions. So that is not the entire correct answer, but yes, it is very close. The first consideration that you have to make while developing a hatchback or sedan or SUV or any vehicle for that sort is the spacing and the ergonomics. So first, you have to define what will be the space occupied by the vehicle. For example, if it is a four-seater vehicle, if it is a two-seater vehicle like a Mustang or a hypercar. So first, you define that. Then you define your engine size, like what is your engine size and your trunk or boot space. When you do these three spacing, you get an overall rough idea of what the length and the breadth of the car should be. Once you get an idea of the length and the breadth of the car, so all this is done by the vehicle dynamics engineer himself. So as you can see, he should be aware of the ergonomics department, what the ergonomics department is doing, what is the size of the engine and the powertrain components which the powertrain team will be using, then your interiors and exteriors too. So he has to understand and study all of that, and only then he can have a concept and build a concept in his mind. Like, yes, this is the amount of space I'll be required, that will be required in the car. Once he figures that out, what he will do is he'll define the 4 points, that is your four tires, where the four tires are going to be placed at what length and what breadth. So the length between the two tires is called as wheelbase, and the width between the two tires is called as track width. So he has to define the wheelbase and the track width, and only then he can proceed with his vehicle dynamic process. So in order to do this, as you might have gotten the idea of, he has to understand the complete architecture of the vehicle, where each component is going to lie, what amount of space they are going to occupy. So he has to study the vehicle architecture first and understand the overall build setup of the vehicle, and only then he can proceed towards designing his suspension and steering setup. Now, while designing his suspension and steering system, he has to also focus on various components of your suspension and steering systems, which we'll be seeing later on. What are the different components? Like how many control points he is going to be using, how many control arms will be there, which type of suspension and steering setup he'll be using, whether it will be a double wishbone, whether it will be a McPherson strut or a pushrod suspension setup. So based on that, he'll be developing an architecture for the vehicle. Then he'll have to select and design various parameters of the vehicle, like what will be the camber, caster, and based on that, he'll be developing the entire suspension and steering setup. Also, he'll be responsible for choosing which tires go on, because each tire has a different sort of construction. It is made up of different materials and it has different applications. Because you have your off-road tires, you have your wet weather tires, you have your slicks, which are used in slicks are more used in motorsport applications. So he has to consider those, and he has to select a tire for the vehicle also. And then he'll be determining the entire suspension and steering setup. Once he has developed the entire suspension and steering setup, only then can you proceed towards designing your chassis. Now, most of the people that have asked this question too have responded that the first thing that anyone should build in the car is the chassis, which is completely wrong. Because chassis is never the first thing that you build. Why? Because what is a chassis? Chassis is nothing but a big bracket which holds each and every component together, correct? It is meant to support the seating of your driver, the powertrain components, etc. So until and unless you know where each and every component is going to lie, how each and every component is going to be placed, what size they'll occupy, how are you going to design a bracket to hold them, correct? So chassis should actually be the last thing that you design and the first thing you manufacture. That is where people get wrong. When it comes to design, chassis should be the last thing that should be designed, because once you have each and every component in place, you already have a rough idea of the rough skeletal architecture of the chassis with you, because you just need to join the points for your control arms, for your power chain units, etc. But when it comes to manufacturing, the opposite needs to happen, and the opposite does happen in most automotive plants. If you go for internships, you'll be able to see it, that the first thing that gets manufactured is the chassis, which will be done in your BIW shop. BIW is again a very interesting field. You guys should look into it. It is a very budding field in India, and there are lot of employment opportunities currently. Actually, BIW is the biggest employer in the mechanical design, the research and development industry when it comes to, and even the manufacturing industry. So try getting associated with BIW also. Moving on, because there's not a BIW workshop. So once the chassis and the BIW gets built, then you have your powertrain components getting assembled, interiors, exteriors, and at the last, you'll have your suspension and steering geometry get fitted into your car, followed by your electronics and your brake fluids and other cooling fluids, etc. So that is that. So once the entire car is built, again the vehicle dynamics engineer has a role. That is, he needs to test the car. So the vehicle dynamics engineer needs to, now there are some vehicle dynamic engineers who are very good drivers themselves, so they do the testing themselves and then they tweak the suspension and steering system. So, but in most cases, what we have seen is any automotive OEM or startup for that, say, so they have specified testing drivers. So these vehicle dynamics engineers will sit along with the testing drivers inside the vehicle, and the testing driver will be pushing the car to its absolute limit in the testing tracks of these automotive companies. And then the vehicle dynamics engineer will be making certain assessments, like how the vehicle is performing under certain conditions, such as cornering, brakes, bumps, etc. Then he'll see whether it meets the required requirements. Like, for example, he wants the vehicle to undergo a certain degree of roll only, but let's say the vehicle is rolling more than required, then he'll understand that the suspension and steering setup needs to be recorrected, or let's say the roll bars, anti-roll bars, need to be more stiff or less stiff compared on the performance. So again, he'll be required to tweak the entire design process, again the manufacturing process. So most of this is done during the prototype phase, and once the entire prototype is built and the entire build of the car is finalized, then it is not necessary for him to test it on each and every car. But of course, yes, he'll be doing quality checks. Like, let's say he'll be testing two or three cars in a sample of, let's say, 60 or 70, whether these cars are having the exact same driving performance or not. So this is the basic job of a vehicle dynamics engineer. Now, you can, if you want to get employed as a vehicle dynamics engineer, you can approach almost all the OEMs. Most of the OEMs now have the research and development facilities in India. You have most of them in Chennai, actually. In Chennai, you'll have your Nissan RNTBC, which is almost towards the outskirts of Chennai, near Mahindra World City, I guess. So there, Nissan has their research and development facility. You can get employed there as a vehicle dynamics engineer. You can get employed in Ford, Mercedes-Benz, Tata Motors, Mahindra. All of them have their research and development centers in India itself now, which was not the case previously. Previously, most of these companies used to have their research and development centers outside India and only the manufacturing centers inside India. So you'll be able, if you are employed as a vehicle dynamics engineer, you can join these companies. Apart from that, you have now the options of joining startups too. Now, one thing I would like to tell you from my experience is that when you are starting your career, I'm talking regarding this with respect to the freshers in this session. So when you're a fresher, if you're trying to learn more, because as a fresher, you lack skills, correct? I'd say invest the first 2 years in a startup. There are various automotive startups which have now sprung up in India. You have Ather Energy, Ultraviolet Automotive, even Ola Electric. They are trying to develop electric vehicles. Then there are like n number of electric vehicle startups. So try joining them. Even they have huge requirements of vehicle dynamics engineers for their ranks. So you'll be learning a lot more. So once you have learned a lot, once you are confident with your skill, then try to move into an OEM like Tata Motors or Ford, etc. So that will be my advice. Try joining a startup in the beginning of your career. And that is that. And when it comes to the compensation offered, so at the beginning, when you're joining as a vehicle dynamics engineer, most of the times the compensation offered is pretty good. I wouldn't say it is the best, but it is quite decent. Most of the times it is somewhere around the 4 to 6 LPA range, so which is quite a decent amount for a fresher. And especially vehicle dynamics engineers have huge opportunities of going abroad because apart from having their research and development facilities in India, most of these companies like Nissan is there. Even if you're in Tata Motors, you can get the opportunity to work in Land Rover, etc. So most of the vehicle dynamics testing tracks are actually present outside India. So you have various opportunities to go abroad too. So please take up this field seriously. It is a very nice field. It is a very intriguing field. It will always keep you, the job profile of a vehicle dynamics engineer, you won't ever feel bored for a single day in your throughout your job because every day you'll be facing with a new challenge. How to tweak the suspension setup, how to get more performance out of the vehicle. It's a very performance-oriented job environment. And so here that this is the end of the workshop session for today, as we have discussed in the agenda. Tomorrow we'll be starting with different suspension parameters and we'll get into more technical details. So this was the most of the general stuff when it comes to vehicle dynamics. Now moving over, you can ask your questions in the chat box for the session today. Can you explain BIW? Yes, for sure. BIW is nothing but body in white. So body in white basically refers to just give me a second. Yeah, body in white refers to the basic chassis of the vehicle. Now previously cars used to have the ladder and frame chassis, but nowadays the chassis is completely monocoque, which is referred to as BIW. Or if you ever visit an automotive plant, you'll get the entire picture of a BIW. Let me just quickly show you using Google Images that you get a better idea of what exactly is a BIW. So this is the basic architecture of a BIW. It's nothing but the chassis of the vehicle. So here you have your door assemblies, your trunk lid, again your suspension towers, your ABC pillars, your roof, etc. So this is the basic BIW. Which software would be best for vehicle dynamics? Now, there are a number of softwares that are available for vehicle dynamics, such as you have your Lotus Suspension and Steering Analysis, which is the most popular amongst freshers, and it is a very easy tool, and you can easily start learning using that tool. But I personally recommend if you are looking to start as a fresher, start with Lotus. And once you are accustomed with Lotus, you can of course move to more let's say complex or better vehicle dynamic softwares. You have your Adams car. Adams car is one of the best and it is one of the industry standards used to measure vehicle dynamic performance. And apart from that, you have another software which has recently come up called CarSim. So CarSim is also a very good vehicle dynamics platform where you can design and set up your suspension and steering system, and you can also simulate them in real time, like how they are going to run in the actual road conditions. Now, some people also use Ansys and SolidWorks to simulate vehicle dynamics performance. I personally wouldn't recommend that. These are very good softwares for your FEA analysis and your stress analysis, force analysis, etc. But when it comes to analyzing vehicle dynamics, it's a whole other game because you need to know about your camber rates, spring rates, roll rates, how your kingpin is getting deflected. So there are various parameters involved, which we'll be discussing tomorrow. So for that, I'd suggest try to start with Lotus. If you're already good at vehicle dynamics, if you know the basics, then I'd say directly jump towards Adam's car or Karcher. What is the role of multi-body dynamics in the vehicle dynamics field? It is mandatory for a person willing to become vehicle dynamics engineer. He should learn the multi-body dynamics. So multi-body dynamics is nothing but it is a study of dynamic behavior of interconnected or rigid bodies. So what it does is when you're studying vehicle dynamics, you are figuring out how the entire vehicle is going to move, correct? How the tires are going to respond, how much camber. Most of the vehicle dynamic studies around certain parameters such as vehicle dynamics and vehicle dynamic parameters such as camber, caster, etc. But when it comes to multi-body dynamics and multi-body dynamics, you'll be understanding how the motion of the vehicle is affecting the components like your control arms, how much stress they are undergoing, the shock absorbers, how much stress they will undergo, how much buckling forces will, if the shock absorbers are going to buckle or not. So that is multi-body dynamics. So yes, it is interrelated. If you are learning vehicle dynamics, it is of course beneficial that you learn multi-body dynamics as well. Do we have to install Lotus in our PC for the fourth day project? Yes, it is completely your choice. Actually, I'll be showing how to build it from scratch. So you can learn just by viewing also. But of course, it is better if you get hold of a software. You can get the software from the official website itself, which is the Lotus company. Lotus is actually a British automotive company. You can contact them for the license, and there are various other sources also. I'll try to get a hold of the software and provide to you guys beforehand. Can you explain dynamics of aircraft or watercraft? So actually, no, I'm not from the aerodynamics industry. So, or aerospace industry, sorry. I'm not from the aerospace industry. I'm from the automotive industry. So I don't have much of an idea how airplanes or aircrafts work. I just know the basic fluid dynamics principle, which I guess you guys also know. So there is no point in discussing how aircrafts and watercrafts work. So but I'm sure you'll get courses for that too also in this current era. There are online courses for almost each and every topic out there. You just need to get a hold of them. You just need to search about these topics and you need to be really interested to learn about these topics. I'm sure you'll get good courses for aerospace engineering or let's say your watercrafts or ships and related engineering fields. How to upgrade in vehicle dynamics engineering while completing graduation? The only way you are going to upgrade yourself is by reading, studying, and learning new things about vehicle dynamics each and every day. Because vehicle dynamics is a very, very fast and a very complex field. There is no, let's say, rigid procedure to vehicle dynamics. Everything is based on assumptions. As you'll see when you come to the designing procedure, everything is based on assumptions and ideas. So there is no fixed way of doing things. So the more you practice, the more you learn, the more better you'll get. Which books should be referred to dig deeper? Now there are a number of books available on vehicle dynamics. For example, you have Tune to Win by Carol Smith, Race to Win by Carol Smith. Then there is Vehicle Dynamics by Millikan. Now Millikan's books are one of the best and are considered like the standard book for learning everything related to vehicle dynamics. So try to get a hold of that. Tune to Win and Race to Win is more performance oriented. You won't get the entire theory behind vehicle dynamics in it. So I'd prefer try starting with Millikan. It will look a bit, it will appear a bit complex when you start initially, but start researching regarding the various topics and the various terms which you won't get in the first reading itself. But you have to invest a lot of time, and of course you'll get much, much better if you're completely follow with Millikan. Yes, of course, I can guide you in doing projects in vehicle dynamics, and I'll also help you with your research paper also. Just get in touch with Ziksha. They do provide project assistance and research paper assistance for students who are willing to do projects and different sort of research papers. So yes, we'll be providing, we'll be actually very happy to provide support for projects and research papers. How can we as a driver understand the vehicle dynamics of a car while driving a car? Now, for this is one of the, again, while being a vehicle dynamics engineer, you also have to be a good driver. It isn't necessary, but it is preferable to be one. So what happens is, let's say the most simplest scenario, when you are accelerating, what you feel is you get us when, let's say, you're accelerating from 0 to 60 in a very short amount of time. You completely press the accelerator pedal. What happens is you feel a jolt hitting you at the back. So that is not just a jolt which hits you at the back. That is because your car has excessive squat tendency. So you are losing traction on the front two of front two wheels, and you have increased amount of load transfer going towards the rear. As a result, you may end up pulling up a wheelie, as you'll see in Fast and Furious movies. So that is again one parameter how you can judge as a driver. Next will be when you're, let's say, taking a very sharp turn, the amount of let's say you'll experience a push. Let's say when you're taking a left turn, you'll feel your body trying to push towards the right-hand side. So the more that force is pushing it towards the right, that means your car is rolling a lot more. So that is how you judge being a driver, your vehicle dynamics of the vehicle. Yes, there is always concern of vibration in vehicle dynamics. Like I said, when you're a vehicle dynamics engineer, you need to completely understand the motion of the vehicle. So that includes going through bumps and roads, and when your car is traveling through bumps and different road conditions, of course there will be vibrations, and these vibrations will again be felt by the driver. So the more vibrations the driver feels, the more quickly he'll fatigue, and the lesser distance he'll be able to drive through. So yes, vibrations is again a very important factor when it comes to vehicle dynamics. The name of the book, so I'll be actually putting it up in the slide at the end of the complete session. We'll be putting up as a reference for the name of the book. So you can take it down then. Don't worry about it. We got you covered in this topic. So, any more questions? Sure, Krishna, you can send your questions to either right now in the chat box, or if you have too many questions. So if you have many questions, post them to Diksha. I'll just give a drop a mail, and we'll be posting a reply to you in detail so that we can solve your doubts in a much better way. Is it possible to get a job at Nissan R&D with 1 year design engineer experience? Of course, even freshers get recruited as design engineers and vehicle dynamics engineers at Nissan. You just need to have the right amount of skills for it. You need to apply, or you either need to get in touch with their project managers or HRs, or you can directly apply to their online website. And for sure, if you have the skills, of course, Nissan or any automotive company for that say will be happy to recruit you. Yes, as compared to electric vehicles, vehicle dynamics in IC engines is a lot more complex, and it is very tricky too. However, electric vehicles have simplified, and most of the electric vehicles have excellent drivability, as you can see with vehicles from Tesla, the new platform developed by REE, which is another Israeli startup in the electric vehicle industry. So they have developed a very good platform for electric vehicles, in which the vehicle dynamics is much, much simpler.